the intro song sounds good. The intro song sounds very, very, very good. What's going on, gang? This is Serge, and this is episode zero of my newest project, The Happiness Algorithm. This is a YouTube/everything project that I've kind of had concepted out for a little while. This has kind of been my New Year's resolution, so to speak, to get this thing off the ground. This has been some time in the making, and this has been something that I've been wanting to do. Just give me one second while I make sure that all of my stuff here is good. I have to check my stream health and my dashboards. Just got to... Sorry, this is the blues of what happens when you do this for the first time. So just give me 1 minute here. There we go. I have all of my dashboards up. I have all of my stuff connected. I have shared the link on my Twitter. I have pinned the link on my Twitter. So I'm going live to you right now, both on Facebook and on YouTube. So if you're watching this on YouTube, welcome. If you're watching this on Facebook, I'm going to post the link right now. Right now, this is kind of coming from my personal page. One sec. Oof, almost posted the wrong thing. Here we go. All right, so I'm going to wait a couple more minutes for, or not a couple of minutes, just a few more seconds for people to trickle in, because I know how this live stuff goes on. So let's talk a little bit about me, a little bit about this project, a little bit about the reasons behind it, and just some of the inspirations behind the happiness algorithm. So a little bit of an intro. For the YouTube viewers that might not know me, or for the people that might come into this a little bit later, all of you Facebook guys already know me because it's going on the personal page. My name is Serge. I am from New York City. I am 36 years old. I work in computer security. I used to work in the field of news media. And just like everyone else, man, I have been having a really, really, really crazy year since the beginning of 2020. We've all been having a really crazy year since the beginning of 2020, and it just feels like the whole 2020 is bad kind of became this meme that we were all exploring, the meme that we were all living. At some point, I dug a little bit deeper into it, and I made a couple of really interesting and really startling conclusions, especially just coming from my past as well as some of the things that I've read. Now, the happiness algorithm is in its core a personal and total self-improvement project. It is a project that I'm going to be going on. It is a project that I'm hoping that my live audience can go on. And it is just a absolute positive thing. Now, how did this come to be? Well, at some point late last year, I ran across a couple of books, a variety of like classic books on the power of the human brain, stuff like Mind Power by John Cahoe, or like the classic Think and Grow Rich. And it has some concepts that if you ever read one of these books, will probably be very, very familiar to you. They talk about stuff like affirmations and visualization and the fact that you can essentially trick the subconscious mind into doing your bidding for you. The interesting part that I found while reading all of this stuff is that they emphasize that this is happening, this kind of influence over your own mind is happening no matter what is going on. So you could be actively working on your own personal betterment, but at the same time, you're going to be influenced by other outside forces. And I realized that in the modern world, these outside forces, especially through the context of these books and through the context of self-actualization and knowledge of the self, that all of these concepts of affirmation and repetition and just implanting of ideas in our heads is being done to us whether we like to or not, usually through the power of media, through the power of social media and everything else that's around us. So the goal of the happiness algorithm is to figure out a proper concept to help us all along the way. It's to figure out the various ways and strategies that we can use to improve our lives. And it's also a way to use a lot of modern technology and a lot of modern concepts, social media included, to give us the kind of good, positive reinforcement that helps us grow as people. Now, this might seem very hacky and, you know, very new agey, but this is kind of like a concept of what they said back in the communist days. Listen, I was born in the Soviet Union, so I get to make these comparisons. They would say, sure, you might not be interested in the party, but the party is very much interested in you, comrade. So that's the concept. You might not like any of these hokey ideas, even though a lot of them do have plenty of basis and plenty of literature in the fields of behavioral science, in therapy, in childhood education, and a whole variety of fields where essentially people use the power of education to make themselves better. This is the roots of all of these things. Now, with the happiness algorithm concept, these concepts will be applied to all of us, whether we like it or not. And this is kind of where I go in my experience from working in the news media. Now, this is a kind of ties into the title of the show, that the modern world is killing us. Because if we look around at what we do, what we consume, and the environment that we're in, there's a lot of very, very dangerous things that we might mistake for normal that are straight up just going on around us. All right, hold on. Let me make sure all of my stuff is good. So I'm going to switch here to this other view, and we will go over some articles and concepts. Now, there it is, the Brave browser. Now, these first two tabs are essentially the two baseline books that I've read, which gives some interesting concept on how people can essentially hack their brains and hack their minds for an overall better life. Mind Power was the first book I read on the topic. If you've read anything similar, then you've already know some of the concepts, such as talking about the subconscious, talking about visualization techniques, talking about repetition. It's the same thing in Napoleon Hill's classic, Think and Grow Rich. They talk about the concepts of faith. They talk about auto-suggestion. These are concepts that are not new. However, the news media has changed into a 24-hour cycle where information is all around us. Information is always completely and totally brand new. There's always some sort of piece of news meant to take away or to get our attention, to get us to buy something, to get us to believe something, to get us to vote a certain way. And that's causing severely negative effects on our mental health. I prepped a bunch of articles about this, essentially about the state of modern media and news media. This is a classic example of what's going on in the news. Outside of a few select news outlets, that would be the big name cable news channels, I 100% know that those guys are profitable entities. But stuff like newspapers, stuff like news websites are just generally losing money. And here we have an article from CNN that talks about how throughout the past year, a lot of news companies were forced to downsize. Partially, of course, because of COVID-19, but people using ad blockers and people switching entirely to digital consumption of media has really cut into their profit margins. Newsrooms are getting smaller, office spaces are getting smaller, and the strategies that are used by media companies to catch and maintain our attention have drastically changed, especially when the advertising revenue that they get and the share of advertising revenue is smaller and smaller and smaller. Now, we have another example. Here we go. Verizon said to be looking to unload the money-losing Huffington Post. So, Huffington Post, one of the bigger internet news outlets, they have received some controversy in the past for essentially hiring out, having a little blank moment about the proper word to use here, but essentially not paying staff. They just essentially hire a bunch of freelancers to write their article and save money that way. And even with all of that, they still keep losing money. So they have to come up with new and better innovative ways to keep our attention so they can get advertising revenue or subscription revenue from us. We have another article here. Now, this one's a tiny bit dated. This is from 2017, but these trends are more or less continuing. After a peak that seemed to show Sunday circulation actually kind of peaking right around the same time that weekday circulation seemed to be going down. But as you could see, the trend line from essentially the invention of the internet, newspaper circulation is going down faster and faster and faster and faster. And this includes very popular legacy media outlets such as the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, the Washington Post. And because of things like that, a lot of these news outlets have resorted to essentially being bought out and ran at a loss by billionaires. And whatever these billionaires have for interests, that's what will be covered. That's what will be the focus. And the stories that they don't want to talk about, they just won't be talked about. Now, it's interesting because having worked in the news, you realize and you notice essentially how the whole thing is made. They pick and choose their stories. It's like an old R&B song that my friends and I kind of made up on the spot where it's like, baby, you know I'm not going to lie to you, but girl, please don't make me tell you the truth. So admitting the truth is not lying. And if you're, let's say, producing a, 30-minute news show, 10-minute news show, hour-long news show, then a lot of the time, you're not going to be able to have enough time to cover or adequately cover all of the stories that you want to cover. This creates the news media bias that we see today. It does not matter what your political affiliation is. There is undoubtedly bias in the news media. And this leads me to this really interesting article, coincidentally from Cracked from 12 years ago. I remember it because just while I'm doing research on this, I remember this is such a crazy influential article for me that I just completely had to bring it back. The article is 6 brainwashing techniques they're using on you right now. So let's look at them. Chanting slogans. We've all seen people chant a lot of slogans, and that essentially turns your brain off. We've seen essentially terrible headlines that don't really make any sense, because we know that most people don't read past the headlines. We've seen, what else did I have in here? Controlling what you watch and read. They make a really, really interesting point here that we get a little dopamine rush when we agree with something, when we're faced with something that we just vibe with. And the reason I say vibe is because it kind of creates that same atmosphere of like, ooh, it's almost like a little pleasurable dopamine receptor being triggered in our heads. Let's see. Shaming. There's a lot of shaming going on. And anyone that has looked at Twitter for more than 10 seconds knows this. And yeah, do I need to say more? Do I honestly need to say more, fam? What else do we have in here? Oh, good old black and white choices. Good old us versus them. You're either with us or against us. All of this, with the 24-hour exposure that we're faced with, and the fact that because of COVID lockdowns, our internet selves are becoming more and more our real selves, this is creating a lot of various astounding mental health problems. And that's one of the reasons I actually started this project, is because I had this weird day where I actually went to get the microphone that I'm using on this podcast, and I was walking around and listening to various podcasts I listened to, and it made it seem like the world was coming to an end, that we're gonna have, I don't know, a civil war or something, and that everything is burning everywhere. And you know what? When I walked around, when I talked to my neighbors, when I talked to my friends, when I talked to my coworkers, and I talked to my family, and when I had everyday normal social interaction, that simply wasn't the case. But it's a kind of reality that's created because we are in a more and more isolated environment. And this kind of isolated environment is just straight up dangerous. And the internet rewards these kinds of things. Now, don't take my word for it. Let's just all watch the trailer for The Social Dilemma, a movie that I recommend to everyone if you haven't seen it. You might disagree with parts of it, and that's fine, but it does a really good job describing how essentially social media algorithms control our lives, and how we're fed a constant stream of content to keep us hooked as users of these social media platforms. And a lot of it is the stuff that I described earlier. Heck, Twitter itself wasn't profitable until like maybe a year or two ago. Correct me if I'm wrong. But it's the jobs of these social media companies to keep you engaged. And they keep you engaged by throwing you more and more BS, by giving you more and more radical information. And on the flip side of that, the way to get noticed is to have like a quick quip or a one-liner, a nice viral tweet that will, you know, turn you into a little temporary star and give you the kind of dopamine that you desire. So to get that kind of quip, you essentially just have to be the bigger asshole in the room, for lack of a better term. You know, there's jerks on the internet, and you got to be the jerk with the best one-liner. So this doesn't really incentivize good, proper behavior. So let's take a look at this trailer real quick, in case you guys haven't seen it.
When you go to Google and type in climate change is, you're going to see different results depending on where you live and the particular things that Google knows about your interests.
That's not by accident. That's a design technique. What I want people to know is that everything they're doing online is being watched, is being tracked. Every single action you take is carefully monitored and recorded. A lot of people think Google's just a search box and Facebook's just a place to see what my friends are doing. What they don't realize is there's entire teams of engineers whose job is to use your psychology against you.
I was the co-inventor of the Facebook like button.
I was the president of Pinterest.
Google.
Twitter. Instagram.
There were meaningful changes happening around the world because of these platforms. I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
We get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up, and we conflate that with value and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed.
I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Facebook discovered that they were able to affect real world behavior and emotions without ever triggering the user's awareness. They are completely clueless.
Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news.
We're being bombarded with rumors.
Everyone's entitled to their own facts. There's really no need for people to come together. In fact, there's really no need for people to interact.
We have less control over who we are and what we really believe.
If you want to control the population of your country, there has never been a tool as effective as Facebook.
We built these things and we have a responsibility to change it. The intention could be, how do we make the world better?
If technology creates mass chaos, loneliness, more polarization, more election hacking, more inability to focus on the real issues, we're toast.
This is checkmate on humanity.
There we go. So that's the trailer for The Social Dilemma. I really, really hope that I don't get like a copyright strike just from something like this. But yeah, this is the reality that we live in, all right? This is how these algorithms essentially play this monumental role in our lives. And love it or hate it, it's the truth. Now, besides social media and news media essentially battling for our attention 24/7, there is a entire section or this entire wave of side effects that are associated with modern living. Let's go through some of these again. This is an article from 4 years ago about the rise in demand for mental health services after Donald Trump's election win. Again, this is going to be a politics neutral show. This is simply about what modern life does to us and how we can be overall better and happier people. And because the news media and social media have hijacked our consciousness to such a level that something like a presidential election essentially makes us go nuts. Now, we go into this weird reinforcing pattern where, you know, you feel like you have to say something because people you disagree with say something, and then it becomes this whole twisted, convoluted mess. And that's essentially the appeal. That's the appeal to your psyche. And to be honest, no one's immune from it. Heck, 15 minutes before starting the stream, I commented on a news story on Twitter. I see my Twitter mentions kind of blowing up right now. So maybe it went viral, maybe it didn't. But we can't really, really help ourselves. And this is to the point where a lot of people's lives become just completely dejected if, let's say, their candidate doesn't win. And we're seeing the side effects of that. And these side effects are completely astounding. And this is just one example. Like, you should not be going to therapy because of a presidential election. You just shouldn't. You just shouldn't. Straight up. What other completely depressing things about modern life do I have picked out for you? Oh, let's see. Our skyrocketing use of antidepressants. Almost a quarter of women in their 40s and 50s take antidepressants The usage of antidepressants has just overall skyrocketed. And this is from 2011. I know that there are newer and more updated statistics that paint an even more drastic picture, but I wanted to give you at least a respected source. You know, this is Harvard. You know, it's pretty hard to dispute this kind of finding from Harvard. So we become addicted to pills, we become addicted to booze and everything else to essentially mellow out our really, really crazy lives that in a lot of ways we're causing to ourselves. Let's do another one. Are depression and diet related? Well, I don't know. The acronym for Standard American Diet is literally SAD. It's literally SAD. And yes, this finding, again, posted by the Mayo Clinic. You might remember Mayo Clinic is doing outstanding work in cancer research. And I remember doing a little fundraiser for them back in the day. Like, this is a trusted, reputable source. And essentially, if you feed your body terrible things, you're probably way more likely to be depressed. And in the age of COVID-19, the risk of death from COVID-19 is heavily associated with obesity. So it's like even with young people, like I want to kind of dance around the COVID-19 subject because, you know, you say one thing wrong and they'll delete your video. But this has been shown by a variety of sources that if you're overweight and obese, you have a way higher risk of dying from COVID-19. So our terrible diets are killing us in more ways than one. And now in the age of COVID-19, it's becoming even more and more obvious. What else are we doing that's bad? Our increased use of alcohol. This is kind of skyrocketing. Now this is the newest one. I know a lot of people that have dealt with the loneliness that comes from COVID-19 by essentially self-medicating with alcohol. We talked about antidepressants. You know, we've talked about drugs. We've talked about eating poorly. We've talked about now boozing. And that's just a path to nowhere. That's just a path to nowhere. And here is a paper which essentially summarizes that when we isolate ourselves and we cut ourselves off from society, heck, man, it's like going to solitary confinement in prison. You know, they do that as punishment in jails. They do that as punishment in jails. So we are completely over self-medicating. And this is just a really, really crazy thing that's just a symptom of modern life. So with all of this stuff, with the fact that we're kind of faced with this endless barrage of negativity, this endless attempt to get into our heads, this endless attempt to control what we do, and a lot of times to get out of that, to escape those bad feelings, we self-medicate with alcohol, we self-medicate with drugs. There needs to be an effort by all of us to essentially just be better. Like, this entire thing that I just laid out, straight up, that's modern life, okay? That is modern life. Oh, man. Kind of sucks to say. It really does. But we have the ability to change it. We have the ability to come out of these things better people. But we need to focus on so much stuff at the same time that, heck, what else can I say? It could feel overwhelming at times. And this is why I created the Happiness Algorithm Project. So essentially, There's a couple of facets to it, and I wanted to tell you guys about it. First and foremost, I'm going to start doing a weekly podcast, kind of like this. I'll start messing around and putting this on different social media platforms. I'll start making YouTube videos and stuff, just to essentially give you something good and something positive to enjoy and to listen to. Now, on this podcast, we will take very deep dives into various ways you can make your life better. For now, I'm thinking that next week, I'll probably do these things on Monday evenings. Next week, I'll go into more in depth on the power of the mind and the various books and philosophies that underscore how we can essentially start taking control of our own, of our own well-being. And unfortunately now, it has to be a constant 24/7 process. And that all of these things that we talk about, we might even ridicule, like, what the fuck is an affirmation? Like, do I really have to write some stuff in a notebook? And then, you know, you think that's totally corny, but then you end up reading 20 minutes of depressing tweets before you go to bed. You know, that's the reality. So the podcast will focus more on various aspects of ways to improve your life, ways to improve your happiness, talk about stuff that might hinder it, the various obstacles that we can face along the way. And we'll cover a whole bunch of different things, from social media algorithms, diet and exercise, money issues, and of course, the act of constant promotion of positivity. Now, the second thing that I really, really wanted to do, and I'll probably highlight these on the podcast, but I also am going to start posting these on my own social media, is essentially to create a positive stream of social media. So if you're watching this right now and you know of a really, really good YouTube channel that you can learn something from or get good information from or get something good historically, maybe some cool fun facts, maybe some cool fun history, just essentially anything that you can dive into when your brain is kind of looking for a relaxation and off switch. We do it all the time. We do it all the time. I challenge you to look at how much you check your social media. There's on your phone, there's a whole bunch of indicators of how much time you spend on various apps. So how much time do you spend on Twitter or on Instagram or on Facebook? Your phone has the power to tell you now. So take a look and be very honest with yourself. Now, other people might say that you should just go cold turkey and give up all social media, but I figure, you know what, it's here, it's a fact of life, and we can use these things better. There's no need to spiral down this death spiral of negativity. And that's why I want this to be like an entirely happiness focused project, because there's various components to happiness. There are various ways that we can essentially, essentially break our own positivity and get into a bad mindset or a bad state. There's, you know, I don't want you to become like some crazy bodybuilding monk and then, lose yourself when, your friends invite you out to go watch a football game. Heck, I watched a football game with my friends this past weekend, and it was great. We sat at a bar. It felt really nice. You know, the bar had one of those outdoor-indoor sections like they do in New York, and I got to watch a little bit of Tom Brady-Drew Brees action. It was a lot of fun. So it'll be good practical strategies to essentially increase your happiness levels. And isn't that what we want? Isn't that what we want? So that is pretty much it for now. The stream has been going for roughly 40 minutes. Nothing too crazy to add. Keep an eye out on my various social media. I'll post things on my YouTube channel, on every piece of social media that I have. If you like it, please subscribe and share. If you have any suggestions for good positive media, good positive content creators, and just generally good things that you can throw in a playlist and then just feel good, whatever it could be, then send it to me. It'll be very useful to all of us. So that's it for now. This is available on my YouTube channel. And we'll be back next Monday. I'm thinking that the next episode will be more focused on just straight up the power of positivity and the power of the mind. And I'll do some of the research on that and some practical ways we can implement that. But who knows? This is an ongoing project, and this is something that I've been wanting to do for a while, just because the state of the world feels so sorry and so crazy around me that I felt like I had to do something. So, again, if you're tired of all the negativity, if you're tired of having your brain hijacked by the media or social media or negative thoughts and influences, then like and subscribe, stay tuned, and we will all get better through this together. All right? Anyway, I have been Serge. This has been episode 0 of the Happiness Algorithm Podcast. And I will see you next time. Peace.